Well, praise the Lord, gentlemen. How was everybody's Sunday? Being blessed with a little bit of rain, so the flowers bloom nicely. As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. He's worthy of praise. He's worthy of sharing. I will talk to my brother. God's mercy today. All right then. He's worthy of praising. This is Psalm chapter 30. I will exalt you, O Lord, for you have lifted me up. I call to you, Lord, for help, and you healed me. I will rejoice in the morning, at noon, and at night, for you show mercy to me.
Without you,
fall apart. You're the one that guards my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
My righteousness, oh God, how I need you.
Hallelujah. What happened there? It's all cold. The Holy Spirit is here right now.
I can feel you flowing through me. Holy Spirit, come and fill me up. Come and fill me up. Love and mercy. Fill my senses. I am thirsty for your presence, Lord. Come and fill me up, Lord. Let your mercy
completely.
Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us, set
give me another hymnal here. Give me another hymnal here. I don't have the music for it. Give me a hymnal. They grab me a hymnal. I don't have the music for it. Well, these are holding the phone right now.
Oh, there's no chords in those. So what? I'll just say the chords. I wanted to practice and refresh myself.
All right.
So let me see if I can just play through it once, and then I'll pull up.
I have it in D in the car. Yes, G.
Say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice.
Okay. I don't know any of them by heart, but I'll go. I have the tune in my head, so I can go.
Maybe it's she the chords are a little well, you know.
I know the tune in my head, so you start playing, I'll go along with it. Okay.
Thirsty land, he hideth
that sound?
Thanks, David.
We have time for one more.
Well, victory in Jesus.
Yes.
Okay. Or work yourself
out. You tell us how to stop it. These guys are going to come
No, they ate.
They ate, yeah. We already had, yeah.
It's one way.
But they are hungry for some other kind of food. The real food. The everlasting food.
Spirit of the living God and F.
Ball fresh on me.
In F.
You need a new mic that has a wire that's bad. It's the wire. Yeah, it's in the wire.
It's in the wire.
It's in
the
wire. Does the mission have a mic?
It has nothing to do with the plug. It's in the wire itself.
It's the wire itself. And I think it's more right in here.
That's probably the case. There or over on the mic end. Somebody bent the wire too hard.
Yeah.
Separate the metal, that's right.
Yeah.
At any rate, I made my living using my voice.
That's right.
And nothing wrong with my voice. I understand my Lord was out in the wilderness.
Come on.
Talking to 5,000. And at that time, they didn't have microphones. But somehow he was able to teach and reach. So praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
God is good. It's just a wonderful opportunity to be here. My name is Sister Linda Jackson. I am here with Brother Tony Chittery and
Tony.
Sam Smith. And we attend the Hilltop Community Church. And we're just happy to be with you today.
Amen, amen.
I was talking with Brother Adam Don, and I told him that I thought perhaps you all gathered at 7 o'clock and ended at 8 so that you could go and have
We used to be that way. Used to be that
and
way.
He informed me that it used to be that way. The reason I said that, I remember when it used to be that way.
Yeah.
I first started working with the Richmond Rescue Mission. You ready for this?
Yes.
Since
1968.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. It was just a few years, maybe about 2 years. I don't even know if it was quite 2 years when Brother Larry first established the rescue mission. Richmond did not have anything like that here. And the Lord laid it upon that brother's heart. I know you probably already know that story, but thank God you have something to be rescued. There's something, a place of refuge for
Amen.
You. Especially Amen. To get you out of this weather
Amen.
And to feed you. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So I can tell you some stories about some people in some other countries. In fact, I just ago where they had nothing left. Oh, there's no soup kitchen. There's no rescue mission. There's no place at the food pantry. There's, you know, they had nothing. Nothing. When I say nothing, they had nothing. But thanks be unto God for the burden that Brother Larry had many years ago. You don't even know him, but thank God he's in heaven getting his reward. Because he had a burden for people like you and me that you would be able to take you out of the storm. It may not be Malibu, and it may not be Hollywood. Am I right? But then I thank God for it. So let's give the Lord. Opportunity. You said the foxes had holes and the birds had nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. And we thank you today, Father, because you provided a shelter for your people in the time of storm. Oh God, David said, I was young and now I'm old. I've never seen the righteous forsaken nor their seed begging bread. Lord, today we just welcome your spirit in this place.
Amen.
We pray that you would bless and encourage every heart that's here, every man, every woman, every child. We just ask God that somebody's heart today would be touched, that the spirit would be uplifted, that you said in the book of Psalms 3:7, that thou, O God, art a shield to me,
yes,
the glory and the lifter of my head.
Right.
Father, we ask that you lift up the heads of your people today.
Hallelujah.
Oh, God, lift them up, God, in the name of Jesus. Encourage them through your word. Be glorified in their life. Don't let them leave here tonight the same as when they came to you. Oh, in the name of Jesus Christ, we give you glory, Lord. We give you praise and thanks. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Some old-fashioned camp meeting songs. And one is Victory in Jesus. It was amazing. Sam called me just before the service and he said, Sister Linda, really, I practiced Victory in Jesus. And sure enough, the Lord laid this on my heart early this morning. I went to the jail this morning. And this song was on my heart. So I'm so glad we'll get a chance to say it. I don't know if you know it, but I don't think you need it, Brother Tony.
Is that right?
Yeah, so if you know the song, you just sing with us, okay? You ready?
If you use the hymn book, it's number 82. Page 82. I heard old, old stories, how the Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory.
He loved me too.
song of victory.
Power, wonder-working power in the flesh of love. I get hope that if you begin to sing about the power in the blood of Jesus, in Africa, things begin to happen. Amen. Yes, the deaf begin to hear, the people begin to walk, the blind begin to see. See, people have, I don't know about the rescue mission, you know, but I tell you, you know, up there in Africa, people, when you talk about the blood of Jesus, they get excited.
Yes.
Amen?
Hallelujah.
Yes,
indeed. Hallelujah.
There is power.
Power.
In the blood of Jesus. It's not, this is not a story. This is not a kind of make me feel good song. There's real power in the blood of Jesus. Before I get into what I want to share tonight with us, a few days ago I was meditating on God's word, and I got what I consider to be a revelation. You know, the scripture tells us that without the shedding of blood,
there is no remission of sins.
There is no remission, no forgiveness of sin. Without the shedding of blood. This was around Easter, give or take. Was meditating on God's word about the death of Jesus. And you remember that Jesus, the shedding of his blood did not begin at the cross. Amen?
Amen.
When they wove the crown of thorns and they pushed it into his head, oh, some blood began to be shed.
That's right.
When they began to whip him, you know, with a, you know, that long whip with a metal sword in it, his blood was being shed. As he carried that big old cross,
yeah,
with the bruises and the thorn on his head, he was shedding his blood.
Yes, he was.
And every drop of blood along the way, the mercy of God was being released. The mercy of God was being released. See, you need to learn how to apply your faith to the things that work. Amen?
Amen.
If God will open your eyes and you see the blood of Jesus and what it is good for, your life will never be the same again.
That's right.
You begin to experience things you never knew you could experience before. So in the course of the message tonight, I just pray the Lord will open your eyes so you can have a peek into the mind of God. Have a window and see things the way God sees them. Because it will change your perspective. Change the way you think. Sister Linda told me something a few weeks ago, which I'll never forget. She said, same mind, same result. Change mind, change. You change your view of Christ Jesus. You alter the realities of your life. You view him as the glorified Son of God, exalted high above the heavens, far above principalities and powers. Suddenly your reality changes. You view him as the glorified Son of God.
Yes.
Whose blood made a passing way for you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Paul said, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace.
Yes.
That we may obtain help.
Help.
The time of need.
Yes.
The woman tonight who may be struggling can obtain help.
Hallelujah.
The man who is struggling with addiction can obtain help. There is help to be had through the name of Jesus.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
These are truths waiting to be used by the sons of men. So I pray tonight that the Holy Spirit would open your eyes of understanding.
Amen.
So you see what men of old saw and never look back. I used to wonder, I think I spoke about this, you know, probably in our last meeting here. I used to wonder, why were the disciples after the Pentecost, why didn't they look back? Why were their faith so solid, so fixated, that nothing could, you know, waver them? I mean, imprisonment and floggings and beatings. They couldn't be swayed. They saw something. They learned of something that rocked their lives.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen. My Lord.
Do you know there are things you see and you are forever impacted by? I told a story maybe here some time ago. As a 14-year-old high school boy in Nigeria, I made the mistake of my life. I went to watch a public execution. I tell you, don't do it. Amen?
Amen.
I thought it was a fanfare. People were going, you know. In those days in Nigeria, if they were to kill somebody, they line up in the market square, you know. And so we thought we were going for a cinema or something. And at the end of the public execution, my heart was damaged at 14.
Wow.
It was difficult to unsee what I had seen.
Yes, indeed.
And it haunted me for many, many years. In the same way, spiritually, you can be allowed by the grace of God to see Jesus differently. To see your sins being taken away. To see your sickness healed. And with that revelation, you press into God. And your life, you will never look back. That's the experience we need to have. God, the concept of God shouldn't be for you, you know, a hearsay, you know, maybe, you know, he loves me, maybe he doesn't. No. Should be seared in your heart like a tattoo. So it doesn't waver. Amen?
Amen.
We are in for a great night tonight. Amen?
Amen.
Let's bow our heads to pray. Father, we thank you because there is no one like you in all the earth.
Yes, Lord.
It's none besides you. We love you. We worship you tonight. And Father, I pray that in the course of the remainder of this service, that you will glorify your Son, Jesus. You cause our hearts to be lifted up and be joined with yours. For you said he that is joined with the Lord is one spirit. Oh God, we pray that you will help us that we might see you for who you are. The Almighty God, who is gracious, who is merciful, and who cares for each and every one of us. Holy Spirit divine, I ask you to have your way tonight. Will you minister to the very depths of our hearts and cause us to get a revelation tonight? Cause our faith to rise up and bring a permanent change. We thank you, we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Are you ready?
Amen. Amen.
now to the gospel according to Luke. Luke in chapter 15. Very popular passage. Luke in chapter 15. Beginning to read from verse 1. Then all the tax collectors and sinners and all the sinners drew near to hear him speak. The Pharisees and scribes complained, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." So he spoke this parable to them, saying, "What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he loses one of them, does he not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one which was lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing, calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost.' I say to you that likewise there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 just persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the whole house and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls her friends and neighbors together, saying, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found the peace which I lost.' Likewise, I say to you, there is joy in the presence of angels of God over one sinner who repents." Verse 11. Then he said, "Certain man, 2 sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the portion of goods which falls to me.' So he divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and journeyed to a far country. And there he wasted his possessions with prodigal living. When he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his field to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the parts that the swine ate. No one gave him aid. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have bread enough to even to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.'" Verse 20, "And he arose and came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him, and he had compassion, and he ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven, and in your sight I'm no longer worthy to be called your son.' But his father said to him, to his servants, 'Bring out the best robe, put on him, put a ring on his hand and a sandal on his feet, and bring the fatted calf, and here, kill it, and let us have, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead, is alive again. He was lost, and now it is fine.' And they began This is a very fascinating account that Jesus provides us. Before I begin, I want to let you know that if you needed to believe anybody talking about heaven, you need to believe Jesus.
Right.
Jesus said, no one has seen God at any time, but the only begotten of the Father. He has declared him, made him known. He has unveiled the Father. Now, parables, Jesus popularized parables. Parables are illustrations using earthly things that we are familiar with to describe to us exactly how the kingdom of God functions. Using illustrations, thank you, right? Illustrations about farming, illustrations about, you know, keeping, you know, sheep, illustrations about the weather, illustrations about fishing, to give us some understanding about exactly how God sees things, exactly how heaven operates. And so in this passage we see the Bible identifies two categories of people that were coming to Jesus. The first category were called tax collectors and sinners. Now tax collectors were loved in those days. They were not, you didn't want to have a tax collector as your neighbor.
No.
They were seen as traitors. They were seen as, you know, agents of Rome. They were collecting taxes from the people on behalf of the Roman government. And because they were, you know, corrupt people, they also added their own commissions upon the tax. And so people didn't like them at all. And so in the view of the people, the tax collectors were the worst sinners you could hang out with. I said in the morning today, you know, kind of as a joke, I said, no, they are like policemen and politicians in my home country, Nigeria. Amen?
Oh, man, that's
you don't want to be a police, you don't want a police officer to be your neighbor. Ever. And you don't want a politician either. Praise the Lord. The other group of people were the sinners. It's surprising that they are called sinners. Because everybody you knew, you know, has sinned, the Bible says, for all have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. But you see, there were people whose sins were so obvious that everybody knew they were sinners. They were labeled as sinners. Maybe a woman on the street, maybe a gangbanger, he was so bad, so evil, people knew when he walked the street, they said, oh yeah, that's a gangbanger, he's a sinner.
Right.
And so, when the Pharisees saw these two categories of people come to Jesus, draw near, the Bible said they drew near to Jesus, they wanted to hear more about the kingdom of God. And do you know that when a man or a woman is hungry about the things of God, when he has ears and a large heart and he draws near, he may be a sinner, but God is excited about that company. So when the Pharisees and the scribes, who were religious figures, who were private sinners, who covered themselves with a long robe and covered their sin, when they saw these other people, they said, how can Jesus be mingling and eating with these other people? And Jesus saw their hypocrisy. He saw their cloak of righteousness. And he told us this parable about how God saw things differently.
Yes.
The sum of what Jesus tells us in the first two parables is that the mercy of God, the love of God for us, is so great that He will stop at nothing until He restores us into full relationship.
Yes, indeed.
He says God will put everything He owns at risk in order to find me and you when we have become prodigal, when we have become wayward. Isaiah tells us that, you know, every one of us has gone off to our own way. He says, if a man had 100 sheep, and the 99 were safe. But one of the sheep had wandered off. He will leave that 99. He will spare no expense until he finds the one sheep that was gone astray. And when he finds that one sheep, he will rejoice greatly.
Yes, he will.
You see, the love of God for you and the love of God for me will compel him to do unbelievable things.
Mm-hmm. Yes, amen.
The Bible tells us, for God so loved the world. His love was so great, He couldn't stay in heaven by Himself. He came looking for us. He came searching for us. And when He came around, He saw that we were so far gone, and He was going from house to house.
Yeah.
Looking for us.
Search.
Then He tells us this second, a third parable about the lost son. Many of us know the parable of the prodigal son. He preached so many times, so many places. But I just want to draw a few important points tonight. The Bible said this young man, he might have been a teenager, possibly. He was so anxious to get out of town. How many of you here have children? Many of you have children. You know, when our kids begin to be teenagers, 17, 18, home begins to be a little bit old-fashioned for them. Amen? They want to move out. They may be moving down to the next street, but it feels so different. This young man, he took what he felt belonged to him. The Bible said his father gave him of his livelihood. Now, remember I told you, Jesus is giving us a picture of the kingdom of God. Every detail in that parable describes the kingdom. What is God's livelihood?
Glorious.
Life.
He gave us His Son. See, the concept of sonship in the Jewish tradition is a very powerful concept. Everything a man owned rested on the son. When Abraham was old and he didn't have a son, he felt like a failure, even though he had animals and wealth and servants. He didn't feel content. He began to cry to God. He said, Father, Lord, you know, what will you give me seeing I go childless? A son was a powerful thing. And God gave us His only begotten Son. He gave us the keys to His kingdom. He gave us the heir to His throne. He gave us everything He had. Remember the Bible said when Isaac was born, Abraham gave everything he had to Isaac. Isaac was a type of Christ.
Yeah.
See, you don't understand. When the Bible says this man gave his livelihood to his son, he poured everything he had.
Yes, he did.
And this young man took off. He went into a far country. And he began to live, he began to spend friends began to come. You know, when you have money in your pocket, oh, your friends are many. But when that money runs out, those friends will disappear, you know, like the snow on a hot afternoon. The Bible says there arose a famine in that land.
Yeah.
I find it interesting that the famine was not everywhere.
Yeah.
It so happened the famine was in that specific place where this young man was.
Yes.
Do you know that sometimes the Lord will induce a famine in your life?
Come on.
That's right.
In order to draw your attention.
Yes, indeed.
He will induce a famine in your life. Because he knows that if he leaves me and you to our own devices, we will destroy ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says there is a way that seems so good to a man. You get some money in your wallet to head to San Pablo Casino. That's a way that seems good to a man.
Yeah.
When I lived in Hamburg as a student, you know, they were telling me, oh, have you been to a red light district? Every tourist that came to Hamburg wanted to go to a red light district. And I asked them, I was naive. I said, what is a red light district?
Keep it real.
The way that seems right to a man, but the end is death.
Yeah.
And so God, in his love and his compassion, he will induce an uncomfortable situation. This young man began to be in need. It was a need that his friends could not fulfill for him. It was a need that the strange master he had joined himself with, the citizen of the far country, could not fulfill. See, listen carefully. You see, when you are in a far country and a famine arises, this spiritual famine, your friends, as nice as they may be to you, they cannot quite fulfill the need of your soul. The girlfriend will not fulfill the need of the soul. Your best buddies cannot fulfill. You will be miserable. God is calling your attention.
Yes.
He just wants you to come back home. Because he has great things for you. He doesn't want you to miss out on the great adventure. And so we see this young man, things began to go from bad to worse.
Yeah.
He began to want to be given the part that was fed to the swine.
Yeah.
Listen carefully. The Jewish people will not have anything to do with swine. But his situation has become so bad that he now was hungering after swine food. That's how despicable. That's how desperate he had become. So many of us, the devil has so much, you know, messed up our life that we are now in a desperate spot. We are struggling for dear life. He's used alcohol, he's used drugs, and he's messed us up, and we can't see clearly. We are just scavenging out in the world. But the Lord can begin to induce a famine in your life. The purpose of a famine is more spiritual than it is physical. It is to draw your attention. If you go to scriptures and you look at every famine that arose, there was most of the time a spiritual undertone. The famine. When there was a 7 years of plenty followed by 7 years of famine in Egypt, it was a spiritual preparation for God's people.
Right.
In the book of 1 Kings, I believe in chapter 17, when there was a famine in the land, he see a widow woman, you know, who could afford God was preparing something. something. God was engineering something, because the famine has a wonderful way of pulling men towards to God, who alone is able to solve every problem.
Yes, indeed. In the law.
So something happens in the heart of this young man. So from the far country where he was, he began to think about home. He began to think about his father. He began to do some personal introspection in his life. He began to say within himself, how many people, how many hired servants at my father's house have enough bread to spare? And I'm living in this situation. He says, I'm going to arise. And I'm going to go back home to my father. And I'm going to say to him, I've sinned against heaven and against you. Now listen carefully. There was something that was triggered in the heart of this man. But he had to face some harsh realities. And he had to make some decisions in his heart. Every repentance that is genuine begins with facing some harsh realities.
Yes, indeed.
The moment you begin to tell yourself, I am not the only sinner in the world. I am better than Mr. X and Mrs. Y. You are not ready for repentance.
No.
When you justify yourself,
yeah,
when you minimize your sin, when you make it look like it's not that bad, all I do is I lie, I don't steal, I don't kill, you know, I'm not so bad. You're minimizing your sin.
That's right.
When you say, you know, my only sin is adultery, I don't steal, I don't kill, it's just this adultery. I remember I had an uncle in Nigeria. He was a drunk. And we'll tell him, uncle, drinking will kill you. He goes, it's only one bottle.
Okay.
Tell him, uncle, it takes just one bottle. And you're gone.
Oh, that's how he died.
Oh my God.
Every sin is deadly.
Yes,
he was a liar. A liar from the start.
Yes, this young man did some reckoning. His situation, he faced it very clearly. It wasn't ambiguous to him. You and I must see sin for what it is. It's a rebellion.
That's right.
Against God.
Seven.
It's an affront to the authority of God in our lives. When I so see my sin, and I realize it is my sin that placed the Son of God on the cross, and I then decide to in myself, I say to myself, I am no longer going to continue to yield my body, yield my mind to the devil. I'm going to repent from my sin. I'm going to go back to God and confess my sin and trust him for the rest of my life. When I make that type of decision in my heart, I must do something that this young man did. The Bible said, not only did he make a decision, he acted on his decision.
Yes, he did.
So many people, they are well-intentioned. But you see, great intentions will never take anybody into the kingdom of God. What takes us into the kingdom of God is when we lift up from the place where we are and we turn around and begin to head home,
yes,
towards Jesus.
Yes, indeed.
Salvation is not all about intention. It's about action.
Right.
He said, I will go to my father. And he arose and began to go. He did something that caught the attention of the Father.
Yes, indeed.
Yes,
indeed. I've learned something
about the kingdom of God.
God responds to actions, not words.
That's right.
God responds to actions, not words. Now, he hears our prayers. Don't get me wrong. When you begin to pray, he looks up. And he's looking at you. He's hearing you. But when you do something, he rises up. Amen? The Bible says when Stephen was being stoned, remember, Stephen was standing tall and courageous as a witness to the cross. That was action. The Bible says God opens his eyes and he sees Jesus. Not just looking, he sees Jesus standing up at the right hand of the Father. When I take some action by faith, I move the hand of God.
Yes,
amen?
Hallelujah.
Are you here tonight? And you need to give your life to Jesus. And I don't just mean raise your hand and pray a prayer. We're going to pray tonight. But you're going to do something about it.
Amen. Take the next step.
When John was preaching, you know, a soldier came to him and said, what must we do? He says, he that stole, steal no more.
Don't do it anymore.
Some action is needed.
Yeah.
And that action is what makes God to get interested in your prayer. And release the power of heaven to support you.
Yeah.
Now hear me out and hear me clearly tonight. See, nothing I can do by itself will rescue me. But God needs me to act on my words in order to give me the power of God to overcome. So when this young man began to headbutt, the Bible paints a picture that is so, so sweet to see. The Bible said he was heading home. I can imagine him famished, hungry, haggard looking.
Wow.
He probably looked different from how he acted. The Bible says while he was yet afar off from his home, his father spotted him. Now, I need you to use your imagination a little bit tonight. His father was probably old. He wasn't particularly athletic. Amen? If you know anything about Jewish traditions, they don't wear sneakers in those days. Amen? They wore a long robe. Wasn't particularly made for speed. The Bible said his father ran towards him. He was old, but he ran towards him. What was propelling this old man and making him run towards his son? He was called love.
Amen.
And compassion. When he saw him, he was filled with compassion. That's how God sees you. God sees you. When he sees you making rising up from the place of defeat and saying, I'm going to go to God. I cannot continue to ruin my life with alcohol, with drugs, with adultery. I'm going to cut out this relationship. And you rise up and you turn and he sees you.
Yes.
He begins to run.
Yes.
Yes, God will run towards you. He will embrace you. That young man was dirty. That young man was tattered looking. That young man probably smelled like pigs. But his father was not offended. He was so glad that he turned and looked. He hugs him. He treats him like royalty. He said, get a ring. Get a robe on him. Kill the fatted calf. The Father's love for you has nothing to do with your sin or mine.
Amen.
All he's looking for is a heart that is turned towards him. All he's looking for is the man who is beating his wife to say in his heart, this cannot be the life that God created me to live.
Yes.
The woman that is walking the street, all she needs to do is to say to herself, this is not a life that Jesus died for.
Yeah.
I am going to arise and go to my Father. And when you take those steps, there may be weak steps, but they are steps nonetheless. When you take those steps, if you don't defeat yourself with unbelief and doubt, if you will take those steps tonight, God will support you. In Romans chapter 8, the Bible tells us a very fascinating story. It says, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus.
Yeah.
You live, walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. It says, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. That law will take a young man, a young woman, an old woman that takes a step. That law will come from underneath you and lift you up.
Yes, indeed.
That's what it does.
Hallelujah.
Victory over sin comes through the power of God. When it comes to a willing heart, not to a coward or a fearful. Jesus says, but a fearful and an unbeliever, they will have no portion in the kingdom of God. Listen tonight, my brother, my sister. You need to be courageous, even in repentance. Because Satan is going to throw some curveballs to you. He's going to put some obstacles in your way. He's going to discourage you. He's going to say, you've cried many times, but you never really repented. He's going to try to discourage you. And if care is not taken, you will fall back. You said, I've tried, it doesn't work. I have news for you tonight. It works.
Yes, it does. Hallelujah.
You're looking at a man who tried and failed many times to get saved. I will hear the word of God in church. I'm sharing this morning at the prisons. And I will want to rise up in my seat and respond. And then I look to my left and my right, I see my friends are still sitting down. I say, oh no, I don't want to give my life to Jesus. What will my friends say? And this happened for quite some time. And the more it happened, the more I realized that I was deceiving myself. Because you see, on the day of judgment, my friend will not be there. My mom will not be there. My siblings will not be there. Paul said, for we all must appear before the judgment seat of Christ. Every man by himself, every woman by herself. You need to make sure that nobody comes in between you and the Father. All you need to do tonight, very simple. Give him your heart as best you could. Give him everything you have. Give him your heart the way it is. Don't linger or wait. You're not going to make it any better. Amen? I have an uncle who is a chain smoker. He's tried everything under the sun. It's hard to quit. He's waiting to quit before he comes to church. Tell him, uncle, don't wait too long. Come the way you are. Come the way you are. is not for people who have cleaned themselves up.
That's right.
Amen?
Right.
It's for people who want to be clean.
Amen.
The song we sang, remember, we said, plunge in today. By faith, that young man made that journey. It was a far journey from a far country. But he persevered. He kept going. He refused to be discouraged. And his father loved every step that he took. So now, God the Father is waiting for many of us. He's waiting for you to take the bold step that will change the trajectory of your life. Satan brings discouragement. It tries to make you think it's not going to be okay. When I got saved in 1986, I was so mad at myself for taking so long.
Amen.
If only I knew what was I waiting for me at the other end of the line. Glory.
Yes, indeed.
So tonight, would you say within yourself, I will return back, regardless of where you may be tonight, regardless of what your circumstance may be, regardless of how many times you've tried and come short, you can still say tonight, I will return to my Father. You can put some action to that decision. And as we pray just a moment, I'm trusting the Holy Spirit to move you by the power that raised Jesus and translate you from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom. All eyes closed, please. Every head bowed. Nobody moving, please. I have a very simple question for you. If you miss the purpose of God for your life, you have no one to blame but yourself. Jesus said, what will it profit a man? Yes, a home. If he found house and a job and lose his house, what can a man give in exchange? There is a decision to be made tonight that trumps every other decision that you can ever make. It's the step of faith towards Jesus. It's a short walk to Jesus. Just a whisper away. So while our eyes are closed, the privacy of your seat where you are, I'm asking you to tell the Lord you're coming home. And you made the death of your heart. You are trusting him to be your rescuer, your deliverer. With his blood, he will redeem you tonight. Make you a son indeed and a daughter indeed. So while our eyes are closed, very quickly I'm going to ask you if you want to take this journey with me. Just wave your hand, we're going to pray very shortly. And make some solemn commitments and declarations. See hands all over the auditorium. God responds when we act. He does. He says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So tonight, support those who raise their hands, who are making a giant step towards the cross tonight. We are going to pray together out loud together in one voice. So let's open this. Say with me, Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
I believe you are the Son of God.
I believe you are the Son of God.
I believe you died for my sins.
I believe you died for my sins.
Jesus, the mind of everyone.